Hi, I'm Seth Boustead. I am the pre-concert lecturer for the Grant Park Music Festival's 2021 season. The concert I'll be talking about today will take place on August 6th and 7th, so you have two opportunities to check out this wonderful concert. It will open up with the Sibelius Violin Concerto, this wonderful, gorgeous, otherworldly piece by Jean Sibelius at the height of his powers, and then it will conclude with Tchaikovsky towards the beginning of his career, his first symphony. Both composers had a tremendously difficult time writing these pieces. Both composers revised and revised and worked very hard, and in both cases, you can't tell at all. You would think that these pieces just flowed effortlessly. I am going to talk mostly about the Sibelius because I got to speak with the violin soloist, Augustin Hadelich, and he had some wonderful insights about each of the three movements. So let's go to Augustin to talk about the piece in general and then the first movement. Great, let's talk about the Sibelius Violin Concerto.
Sure.
So, my first question, I guess, is really from a personal point of view. Can you just talk about your own personal journey with this piece?
Sure. I guess I started playing it when I was 12 years old, but I had, of course, I already knew the piece. I had heard it many times by then, and it was already one of my favorite pieces for violin, just because it's so exciting, so passionate, so just intense. And those feelings kind of haven't changed. Of course, over the years, I've studied it much more in depth, and I guess the thing that was added to that, I still feel the same way about my part, but I think what's added to that is that now as an adult I have a much bigger appreciation of how great the orchestration is, and how this is both a violin concerto and also a kind of tone poem in which he paints a sort of landscape in which the violinist is kind of the protagonist of the story, you know, is moving around it. So, I just really fell in love with the colors and effects of orchestration, which in many parts of the piece feels sort of that there is a threat and there's something ominous about the surroundings. You know, there's he often uses these low sounds from low winds and timpani, these kind of rumbling sounds, and even though the violin is playing very, very high above, it feels like this. It somehow feels like there's danger. You know, I don't know. It's a very it's a very exciting way of writing, and totally unconventional and very different from every other violin concerto. So every time I play it, it's an amazing experience. I have to say, probably my favorite moments are actually the tutti's in the first movement when I don't play, and the orchestra sound just is so overwhelming. It's just like a huge wave of sound that I hear around me, and it's amazing.
Let's hear some of this opening of the first movement. It's a very hazy beginning, as Augustin will talk about a little bit later on in the lecture, and this beautiful sound, and the violin comes in with this perfect melody, and then I'm going to jump up about 3 or 4 minutes into the piece to give you a sense of what Augustin is talking about, this wall of sound that envelops the soloist. There really is this sense in the first movement that the soloist is a kind of heroic figure who's often struggling against nearly insurmountable odds, and you get that sense when the orchestra swells up like that. So we'll hear a little bit of the opening, and then jump in about the middle of the piece.
Thank you.
about Sibelius as a Nordic composer writing cold, austere music, but instead this piece is so emotional. And in fact, he wrote quite a lot of it in Italy, which is about as far removed from the icy wastelands of Finland as you can imagine in many respects. Let's talk about the second movement here. So we're going to move to my conversation with Augustin about the second movement. He will regress for a little bit to talk about that wonderful opening, and I left it in because I love what he says about it, and then we'll get around to the second movement, and then we'll hear an excerpt. Once again, we'll open it up, this beautiful opening in the winds and horns, and then we'll go a little bit further into the movement. Yeah, I was just listening to the second movement before our talk. And I feel like everything you're talking about is present in that, I mean, you know, in all the movements, but especially in the second movement. I mean, the opening with the winds and the horns is just so beautiful. And then the way that it builds, it's almost like it's announcing the violin, which to me is very dramatic. Like the violinist is a hero of the story. And they're saying, you know, like, here he is coming, you know. And then that stormy section later, that whole big D minor stormy section. Everything you're talking about is absolutely right. It's this heroic journey. There are some stormy moments where things are maybe not working out so well. And yes, the orchestration, I mean, is a vintage Sibelius, I think, in that respect.
It's very epic somehow, the scope of it, which is kind of typical of that phase of Sibelius's writing, is this these epic landscapes. And I mean, the very opening of the concerto, I think this is actually the first violin concerto for which you can't make a piano reduction. I mean, of course, there is one and people use it, but it sounds nothing like the real thing. Because even the very opening of the piece, this effect that the first and second violins do, that's just like a kind of hazy, foggy flickering of notes. You can't actually do that you can't imitate that on the piano. So it's kind of, you have to hear the real orchestral thing, like playing it with a pianist. When I was a student, was actually not helpful in a way. But so that's very opening. It feels like a kind of misty landscape. But my first entrance, I think actually everything I play, he also usually writes things like espressivo, and it like communicates that everything is very, very expressive. I think it's sometimes a stereotype to think that Nordic music is cold and icy, but in this case, you know, there is, I mean, it's easy to associate this music with those kinds of landscapes, but I think that the protagonist, the violin line, is actually very, very emotional. There's sort of an inner warmth that radiates from the violin line, and so that's also something that I find so fascinating. How sometimes the violin line is so passionate and so warm, and the surroundings are so cold and kind of forbidding, you know, what the orchestra is playing to that. I guess the second movement theme is maybe more, a bit more introverted. It's kind of an outpouring of emotion, that theme. But I think of the big opening of the second movement that maybe it's more indoors, you know, you're indoors protected from the elements, whereas in the first movement, you have to face the storm and the ice and all of that.
Okay, let's hear an excerpt now of the second movement. I'm going to start it once again at the opening, because Sibelius is amazing at openings in this violin concerto, in general, but especially in this violin concerto. And then we'll jump up about halfway through the piece, where Augustin says this is mostly indoors or calm, and that is true, but I want to show that there is a little bit of storm even in the second movement. Thank you. I'm going to play a little bit of the third movement of the Sibelius, the exciting conclusion. But first, Augustin Hadelich had some interesting things to say about the violin writing in this work as a whole. Can you just talk briefly about the violin writing itself? I'm not a violinist, but it sounds like it's perfectly written for the violin to me. Can you just talk about that a little bit?
Well, there are different opinions about that, because initially everyone was, of course, complaining that it was too difficult, but that does happen. That does happen with most great pieces, actually. It's a dangerous thing as a violinist to claim that something's unplayable, because then later you look like a fool. So the piece was originally actually also longer, and then he revised it into this shape, which I think is really, really perfect. And it's it was known as an interesting piece, but it was really only a few decades later when people like Heifetz could really, really play it and nail all those octaves everywhere. And that's when it became as popular as it is now. So Sibelius himself, he wanted to be a violinist when he was young. And so he knew the instrument very well. Everything he asked for is perfectly playable and in a way suits the violin. But you can also tell that maybe it had been a while since he played the violin, because some things are really very, very difficult. And I think if he had written it for himself, he would have been a little more reasonable maybe. So I guess the main thing is he does like to write things in octaves a lot. And so there are just a lot of octaves. So I think it's the kind of thing that when a piece like that is first written, it really challenges everyone immensely. But nowadays, every violinist like me, we all grow up with the piece and actually start working on it pretty early on. And so this is one of the pieces with which I sort of learned how to play octaves, I guess. Also, the last movement has some runs that and jumps that are very, very crazy. It's sort of I don't know. It's like Evel Knievel sort of level of risk taking to get to where you need to go. Sometimes, and there's this general excitement. It's because there's this writing rhythm underneath. It's and so you can't take extra time for these runs. You know, you just have to go for it, and it's sort of relentless, which is what makes it so exciting. But certainly is very difficult. But I see what you mean. I mean, it's violinistic in the sense that everything sounds really, really good on the instrument, and it suits the instrument really, really well. But he does not. But Sibelius is not kind to violinists. Maybe it's even his revenge, you know, for revenge on violinists, because he didn't end up becoming a professional violinist. So maybe now he's this is payback.
Okay, this time I'm going to jump right in. I'm not going to play the opening. I'm going to jump right into about 4 minutes into the piece, and we're going to hear where the soloist has to channel their inner Evel Knievel, as Augustine said. I love that idea, the risk-taking, the tremendously difficult passages that Sibelius calls for.
Thank you.
More of the Sibelius Violin Concerto that will open up this concert. And again, our soloist is Augustin Hadelich, and I want to thank him for spending so much time talking to me and having such wonderful insights. He's always a real pleasure to talk to. That will open up the concert, and then we'll go to the Tchaikovsky First Symphony, which he himself subtitled Winter Daydreams. Sometimes composers give the subtitle to their work. Sometimes it's put upon them. In this case, Tchaikovsky very much embraced that idea. As I said at the opening of the talk, Tchaikovsky had a lot of trouble writing this work. He revised it and revised it. He showed it to some of his former teachers in St. Petersburg. They didn't like it, and he had the strength of will to continue forward, and we're all very glad that he did, because this symphony is vintage Tchaikovsky in so many respects. The lyricism, the melodic writing, the sense of orchestration, the craft, the kind of nod towards Europe. He's not really necessarily channeling earlier Russian composers like some of his contemporaries, more interested in what's happening in Europe. The symphony is in three movements. The first movement is by far the longest, and I know that you will enjoy it. It is a marvelous way to close out this program. I'm Seth Boustead. Thanks so much for listening, and I hope to see you at a future talk.